So with this, I once again welcome to all our dear learners, and also I welcome Dr. Ashish Das sir. Very good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Okay, so yes, sir. So welcome to this session, and without wasting any time, so we can now start our session. So please, sir, proceed.
Thank you, ma'am, for the nice introduction. And welcome all the learners. Today we are here to discuss the Managerial Economics PBA Semester 2, Block 1. Sir, could you please share the PPT with the students?
Yes, sir. I'm doing it right now. Just give me 30 seconds.
So basically, the Managerial Economics is basically about knowing, understanding economics and applying it to the decision side. So in managerial economics, what is happening is, this is basically economic theories customized for managers. So a manager is supposed to understand the economics, know economics, and then he should be able to apply in his own business decision making. But basically, in the next slide, I will talk about economics, which is nothing but the study of how choices are made. Or economics is the study of how society manages its scarce resources. Before getting into this particular block, I would like to focus on certain concept which is essential and or which might come in our way of understanding. For example, the first one is scarcity. Now, economics, as I discussed in the first definition or previous slide's definition, is the study of how society manages the scarce resources. But what is the meaning of scarcity? Now, when you look at scarcity, it is not basically in the physical quantity. Scarcity, suppose a goods may be very rare, but there is no demand for it. The quantity supply of that good is very less, but there is no demand for it. It cannot be called as scarce. For example, snake venom. Snake venom may not have any demand in the market, and therefore you may not consider it as a scarce commodity. But the same snake venom, suppose some scientist discovered a medicine out of it, so that this corona problem can be solved, and an antidote for the corona can be discovered out of that snake venom. No sooner they discover this kind of a medicine, this scarce goods will become, this plenty goods will become automatically scarce. So scarcity is always in relation to its demand. If there is demand for a good, then it becomes scarce. And if there is no demand, even if it is the availability is very less in physical term, it cannot be called as scarce. That is the first concept, scarcity. The next one is demand. Demand is nothing but the desire backed by willingness and ability to pay for a commodity. If you have the desire for having a commodity and then the willingness to pay for it, pay money for it, then only it can be considered as demand. Only desire to have a commodity or willingness to buy and no ability to pay for it cannot be considered as demand. Then there are two more concepts, that is positive economics and normative economics, which is there in your SLM. Positive is basically what it is. So normative is what it should be. Now, a positive statement is like, people are not obeying the norms of the government, is a positive statement. But if I say the people should obey the norms provided by the government, then it becomes a normative statement. Next statement is, next concept is inventory. Inventory is nothing but the array of finished goods used in the productions and held by the company. So when you are producing any goods or service, you need to manage or maintain certain inventory so that the production is smooth. Then comes the concept of business cycle. Basically, the economy fluctuates. All the parameters of the economy, like your GDP, your employment, they keep on fluctuating over a period of time. Sometime it might be having recession. Sometime the economy may be having depression. Sometime there is prosperity. Sometime there is a recovery. Sometime there is a boom, like that. So the economy over a period of time passes through different phases. So all business decisions need to be taken after knowing which phase of the business cycle we are currently at, and which type of business cycle or which phase of business cycle we are approaching for. The next concept is forecasting. If you can foresee certain thing, you can plan better. So forecasting is something like predicting the future. So in business, if you know your future demand, it is better for us, it would be useful for us to plan how much product to produce at present, because what we are producing today, you will be able to sell tomorrow. So these are the basic concepts that is discussed here. Then I'll move to the next slide, where we are talking about the economic principles of a manager. Now, what is the role of a manager? Can anyone write or text it? What is the basic role of a manager? The basic role of a manager is to make decisions. So making decision is the basic role of a manager. But why the manager's decisions, managerial decisions are needed? Why managerial decisions are needed? The answer is because there are alternatives. There are alternative solutions to business problems. If you have a business problems, it is likely that you will have multiple solutions to it, and you need to identify as a business manager which is that alternative which is best for you, best suited for your context or your business. So why can't a manager choose any one of the alternatives available? The manager cannot choose simply because each of the alternative have different cost and different benefits. So we need to choose the best combination of cost and benefit. So as a manager, one need to look at the cost, which is less as possible, and the benefit that is as high as possible. Next slide. So what is the objective of the manager? Basically, it is the objective of management is to increase the firm's value. How we will achieve this? The firm value is basically measured through the expected profit. If the expected profit is higher, then the firm's value would be higher. And if the expected profit is low or less, the firm's value would be less. So what is happening here? The expected profit is nothing but the difference between R and C. R is the revenue and C is the cost. Now, if we look at this two, what is the objective of a manager? You would obviously like to increase the R as much as possible or revenue as much as possible. We are looking for a higher revenue, and at the same time, we are looking for a lesser cost. So the firm's sales revenue depends on the demand for its product, which is nothing but P into Q. But R can be more, or revenue can be more, if there is higher Q or higher P. If P increases, our revenue will increase. And if Q increases, quantity increases, P is price, Q is quantity. The product of the two is the revenue of a firm. If the price is increasing given Q, we'll have higher revenue. If the Q is increasing given P, we'll have higher revenue. If both are increasing, still we'll have more revenue. But unfortunately, the firm do not have control over both price and quantity. Either he can decide the price or he can decide the quantity. So given the quantity, if he is setting a price, he should set that price which will lead to maximum revenue. Or given the price, he should decide how much to produce so that the revenue would be maximum. The firm must minimize the cost, the other side, at each level of output. So whatever level of output the firm is producing, given the level of output, the cost should be as less as possible. The next point is the firm must develop strategy that is consistent with the market. That means we have different types of market. So if you are operating in an oligopoly market or in a monopoly market, there is single seller in the case of a monopoly market. In the case of an oligopoly market, there are few sellers, few competing sellers, each of them having fairly large market size. In a monopolistic competition, there are large number of sellers and they are producing competing products with certain product differentiations. But we need to know our product or our industry is in which kind of a market. Based on the markets, we have to develop our strategy. Then the firm's growth depends on the rational investment decisions. And finally, a successful firm deals rationally and ethically with the laws of the regulations. So this is basically broadly the principles, the economic principles that is there for the managers. Now, if you look at management decision problem, it has two wings, or managerial economics has two wings. One is our economic theory. Another is the decision science, like your mathematics, economics, statistics, economics. This decision science and economic theory, when they are integrated, then the subject called managerial economics emerged. This is nothing but application of economic theory and decision tools to solve managerial decision problems. And these problems are optimal solutions to the managerial. We are always looking at optimal solutions. This optimal means optimum, or at some cases it is maximum. In certain cases it could be minimum. For example, when your objective function is cost, you are looking at minimizing the cost. Minimization of cost is an optimum solution. Similarly, maximizing profit, maximizing revenue are all optimal solutions. So both maximizations or minimizations are leading towards optimal solutions. So a managerial economist always looks for optimal solutions so that he can benefit his own firm or organization. Yeah. Next. Next slide, sir. Scope of managerial economics. Now, we look at the scope of managerial economics. In managerial economics, we have got demand analysis and forecasting. A manager obviously has to use this decision science and the economic theory to understand the demand better so that it is possible for him to forecast. And once you are forecasting the demand, future demand, it will be easier for the managers to take production decision. Similarly, cost and production analysis. Suppose you should be able to analyze your future cost and the production analysis. For example, whether in future you need to shift to a higher plant size, or you have to produce in a different location to meet your demand. All these analysis needs to be done. So that is another part of the scope of the managerial economics. Then pricing decision, at what price it should be sold in which market, the policies and practices prevailing in different markets needs to be understood, or different countries needs to be understood. Then profit management, if you can analyze your revenue and the cost, then you can manage profit. Capital management is required. Inventory management is equally important, because if you are overstocking certain things, then you may not be able to, you will be blocking a lot of your money, which will not be profitable. It will not be in the economic interest of the firm or organization. Similarly, one should be very, very concerned about the environmental issues, socio-political environment, and also the business cycle, like depressions, recovery, prosperity, boom, recession. Depending on which phase of business cycle the business is going on, the decisions could vary. In the supply or other economic decisions could vary. Major functions of managerial economics are allocations of firms' scarce resources, investment decisions, the pricing decisions, decisions on how much inventory the firm should be holding, acquiring knowledge about macroeconomic policies, keep himself up to date with the latest technology, understand the implication of alternative arrangement of the business fund, understand the behavior of the consumer and co-producer. Now, allocation of funds resources means you have got previous slide, allocation of funds resources, scarce resources. Because resources are scarce, the manager needs to allocate it efficiently. We cannot waste our resources. We have to judiciously use our resources so that we get maximum out of our resource allocation. Suppose we put our money in a wrong investment. Money is a resource. We will not be able to get any benefit out of it. It may lead to a kind of a sunk cost. Suppose a wrong investment decisions. If you are putting money into a business where there is a lot of sunk cost and you cannot recover, you cannot make profit, then there is a business loss. If you fix wrong price, then there could be less revenue and you would not be able to earn profit. So managers need to be very careful with regard to fixing price, taking investment decisions, allocating resources, and deciding on how much inventory. If you overstock the inventory, then there is going to be loss for the firm because money is blocked and that money would have earned certain rate of interest at least. Similarly, acquiring knowledge about the macroeconomic policy. Now, if the policy changes both at the macro level and micro level are very essential. And if you are not able to adapt to the changing policy, the business may suffer loss. Then understanding implications of alternative arrangement of business finance. Alternative arrangement of business finance means you may decide, the firm may decide whether to go for debt or equity. So these decisions are very essential because it has got certain revenue implications or it has implications for your profit. So a manager needs to carefully decide whether which finance he should be using in his business, whether he should go for debt or equity or any other form of capital like derivative, and there are so many other instruments. Then understand the behavior of the consumer and the co-producer. If you don't understand the behavior of the consumer and the fashion, technology, taste, preference of the consumer are changing, you may be producing outdated product and your co-producers also you have to understand properly so that what kind of strategy they are adopting, you should be well versed with that. Now coming to the next, the demand analysis. Now in demand is basically desired based by willingness and ability to pay for the commodity. So it is basically desire or previous one, desire backed by willingness and ability to pay for the commodity. So all the three components, the desire, willingness plus ability to pay combined together makes the demand. If any component is missing, if you have only the ability to pay but don't have any desire to buy a product, it will not turn it into demand. If you have the desire and the ability to pay but you do not have any willingness to pay for it, then also it will not turn into demand. So to be an effective demand for a commodity, a consumer should have desire, willingness, and ability to pay for it. Okay. Now, next, the law of demand basically talks about other things being equal. The law of demand states that other things being equal, the demand for a commodity varies inversely with price. Inversely means there is a negative relationship between quantity demanded and price. That means if you see in the table, if the price of the commodity is falling from 40 to 30, quantity demand is changing from 10 to 20. Similarly, a fall in the price from 30 to 20 leads to a fall in the quantity demand from 20 to an increase in the quantity demand from 20 to 30. Similarly, a fall in the price from 20 to 10 leads to an increase in the quantity demand from 30 to 40. So this is also given in the graph. You can see the negative relationship or the downward sloping demand curve. As the price falls or as the quantity demanded increases, or as the price increases, quantity demanded falls. So the relationship between price and quantity demand is expressed in the law of demand. However, there are certain exceptions to the law of demand which we shall discuss. For example, in all the cases, the quantity demand may not be falling downward. For example, speculative consumption. If you look at the speculative consumptions, people speculate about the future price. If you can guess that tomorrow the price, other things being equal, suppose the price of a commodity is expected to increase. The gold price is expected to increase. So if the expectation is such that in future the price of certain goods is increasing, there could be higher demand today. Similarly, there are certain goods which is attached to status symbol. If a new brand of car, which is very costly, latest brand, comes to the market, people may feel that if they are having the class, that particular brand of car, they can associate them with certain status. So they are in the upper strata of the society. So they would like to have the car even if the price is very high. But once the price falls at a later stage, they may not be interested to buy the same because everyone else is also having the same car. So no point in having the same one which is already posed by many others. Similarly, given goods here are basically inferior goods where the negative substitution effect is less than the positive income effect. The positive income effect outweighs the negative substitution effect, and therefore the demand curve slope upwards in the case of a given goods. They are inferior goods. So if you it is for certain lower class of society, it is not possible for them to survive without consuming certain goods. So the given goods are inferior goods where if they don't consume that, they cannot survive. Even the price of that goods increases, they tend to purchase more or spend larger sections of their money. Now, let us come to derivation of the individual and the market demand curve. What is the demand curve? In this particular table, you can see both individual as well as market demand curve. For example, C1, C2, C3, C4 are four individual for a particular product. So, if the at different prices, you can see the quantity demand as the price is falling, it is following the law of demand, and as the price is falling, the quantity demanded is increasing. However, it is not uniform across all the consumer. So, for the first consumer, other things being equal or ceteris paribus, when the price is 25,000, he is purchasing only one unit, 20,000, he is purchasing two units, 15,000, he is purchasing three units, 10,000, he is purchasing four units. Similarly, for C2, he is purchasing, this consumer 2 is purchasing 25,000 price, he is purchasing two units, as 20,000, he is purchasing three units. At 15,000, he is purchasing 5 units. At 10,000, he is purchasing 7. Similarly, C3 and C4. Now, when we are talking about the marketing demand, it is the lateral summation of all the individual demand. So, what happens in this case? It is possible for us to aggregate the demand. For example, at 25,000, at price is at 25,000 rupees, what is happening? The market demand is 1 plus 2 plus 0 plus 0, that is 3. So, similarly, at 20,000, you can aggregate the individual demands like 2 plus 3 plus 1, that is 6. Similarly, at 15,000, we have added all the individual demand and arrived at 11,000 as the market demand. And at 10,000, the market demand is 15. So, if you draw either the individual demand, any one of these individual demand, that is C1, C2, C3 or C4, you will get a downward sloping curve. Similarly, if you draw the market demand also, you would be getting a downward sloping demand curve. This is about your market demand schedule and the individual demand schedule and how the market demand schedule is derived from the individual demand. Now, look at this problem. Consider the following three equations. Consumer 1 has a demand function where P equal to 12 minus Q1. Consumer 2 has a demand function which is P equal to 10 minus 2Q2. And consumer 3 is a demand function which is P equal to 10 minus Q3. Now, how do we arrive at the demand function from these three consumers' demand function? This P, when P is expressed as quantity, it is known as inverse demand function. So, we cannot add prices. 10 rupees, 3 rupees, 4 rupees, you cannot add. But we can add each quantity. So, quantities have to be added and not the prices. So, we need to derive quantity as a function of price in each of these cases. For example, in the first case, we can rewrite the equation as Q1 equal to 12 minus P. Similarly, in the second case, we can rewrite the equation as 2Q2 equal to 10 minus P or Q2 equal to 5 minus Q2 equal to 5 minus 2P. Similarly, next slide, sir. Here there is some mistake. This would be a second below. Go down. This Q2 should be equal to 5 minus P by 2. And similarly, Q3 equal to 10 minus P. So this Q2 should be, please correct it, 5 minus P by 2 because this 2 would be divided with 10 as well. So what will happen? We can sum it up and we get a demand function which is nothing but 12 plus 5 plus 10. So this is 27 minus 2.5 P. 27, so Q would be equal to 27 minus 2.5 P. So that is how we are aggregating Q1 plus Q2 plus Q3 and getting the demand function, which is the market demand function. The individual demand functions are there. So what determines the determinants of the demand? The price of the commodity, obviously, because the demand is very sensitive to the price. If there is a change in price, quantity demand will definitely change. But there are other factors too, which affect the quantity demand. For example, income of the consumer. If there is an increase in the income, because of the increase in income, people may consume differently. They can increase the consumption of certain goods because their income has gone up. Or they can increase the consumption of all the goods. The price of related goods, what is this related goods? Related goods could be either a substitute goods or a complement goods. Substitute goods means if the price of a goods goes up, we tend to substitute that goods for some other goods, like tea and coffee. If the price of tea will go up, then people consuming tea would substitute coffee for tea if the price of coffee remains constant. So similarly, complementary goods are tea and sugar, or maybe car and petrol. If the price of car goes down, the consumption of petrol also will go up. So they are complement goods. They are jointly consumed. Complement goods are jointly consumed, while substitute goods are either or type. Either you consume this or you can go for the alternative. Taste and preference of the consumer. If the taste and preference changes also, the consumer may change the demand. Then advertising. We may get attracted towards certain advertised, and then maybe some role model is advertising certain thing, Amitabh Bachchan or somebody else, then you will be tempted to buy that product. So advertising plays a vital role in changing or determining the demand. Then future expectations. Of course, you expect the price to go up because of certain region. Maybe due to a certain region, we are expecting that in future, the price of a commodity is likely to go up. We tend to store things and then we purchase more. Population and economic growth also leads to higher demand for products. If there is a large population size and there is huge economic growth, good economic growth, it may affect the demand for the product. Similarly, availability of credit facility. If because credit is available and installment facilities are available in the bank, people are buying, consumer loans are available, that is pushing the demand up. In the absence of such facility, credit facility or installment facility, people would not have purchased that product. So the credit facility is also determining the demand to certain extent. Then the weather condition. Certain products are demanded, like ice cream is heavily demanded during summer. Umbrella may be demanded in rainy seasons, things like that. So we can express mathematically the demand as a function of different explanatory variables.
Can you please explain once the credit facility? It was not audible clearly.
Okay. Credit facility means bank is providing facility such as consumer loan. Am I right? Bank provides consumer loan. Because the facility is available at the bank end, we tend to get the consumer loan and then purchase the product. So the demand for the product is there because there is a facility to obtain loan from bank. Or the companies provide certain easy installment or zero interest installment facility. So we get the product without paying the full amount. And that is the cause behind purchasing the product. If such facilities were not available, then we would not have purchased the product. Is that clear? Okay. Are you getting?
Yes. Thank you, sir.
So that is how the credit facility leads to that or determines the demand for certain commodity. Yeah, good.
Thank you, sir.
Now coming to the demand function, we have expressed the dx or the demand function as a function of px, where I mean dx is the demand for the commodity of x, which is the dependent variable. Demand for a commodity depends on various other factors like y, income of the consumer, and px, price of the commodity, pr, price of related goods, t, test and preference of the consumer, e, expectations about the future price or income, then d is the demography or the population factor that I was talking, c is the credit facility, w is the weather. Suppose we are writing this in the equation form. Now here we can divide this into two parts. One is a dependent variable, that is dx, depends on rest of the factor. Now here price of x is an explanatory variable and rest of the things are also explanatory. Yeah.
So what is demography?
Demography is the population structure, population demography. Demographic features means how, what is the, see for example, economy having more old age population, okay, may have a different demand pattern than an economy like India where youngsters are more. Am I right? The demography means the population structure. Now we are talking about demographic dividend because we have large number of population, around 60%, 70% populations who are in the working age. So working age group means they are in the age group of 16 to 60. So they can work and earn. They are young, youth. But there are Italy, for example, where the deaths are more in Italy because they have large fraction of old population. There is one of the cause because this corona is affecting old people. Correct? A country.
Yes.
So that is what is demography. So a country with large fraction of populations like Japan, Italy, are old, they would have a different demand pattern.
Okay.
But a country which is basically composed of young people, that may have a different type of demand pattern. So demography and the population growth, the rate at which the population is growing is also a part of demography. Is that clear now?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Credit facility and weather, these two I have explained there. So here, if you look at PX, PX is an explanatory variable, but any change in price leads to change in quantity demand, and the relationship is inverse. The theory of demand is talking that way. So we know that we can expect a sign which is negative in most of the cases, except whether it's a Babylon or what is that, your given goods or status symbol goods, except those cases, exceptional cases. For most of the product, the relationship between demand for X and price of X would be negative. But we need to, that is not enough for a manager. That your theory is telling, but you need to estimate to what extent. So we need to have certain statistical tools and then run certain regression and then arrive at, if there is 1% increase in price, there will be 2%, 3% or 1% or 0.5% change in quantity demand, other things being equal. Here other things is income, price, price of related goods, test and preference, demography, credit facility, etc., etc. Keeping every other factors constant, if there is a change in price, what is happening to the demand for X, that we can estimate. And similarly, keeping other things constant, if there is a change, 1% increase in income, how it is affecting quantity demand. So these kind of analysis are possible using statistical techniques and mathematical economics. Yes. Is that clear now? Can we go to the concept of elasticity? Elasticity is nothing but the degree of responsiveness of quantity demanded to certain variable. What are these variables? Again, these variables could be price, income, and cross elasticity is not price, income, or the price of a substitute product. Okay. So what is price elasticity? Percentage change in quantity demand divided by percentage change in price will give you the price elasticity of demand. Now, when we compute the percentage change or dq by dp, p by q, delta q by delta p into p by q, that is percentage change in quantity demand divided by percentage change in price, we can get five different sets of results. It is possible that the price elasticity could be zero, absolute value I'm talking about. Okay. Absolute value means I'm ignoring negative signs here. So absolute value of EP could be zero, which means there is perfectly inelastic. The demand curve would be vertical in this case. Similarly, if the EP is infinity or price elasticity is infinity, it would be horizontal, the demand curve will be horizontal or parallel to x-axis. In the earlier case, it would be parallel to y-axis. Similarly, when EP is 1, we call it unitary elastic demand. In the case of an unitary elastic demand, the demand curve would be rectangular hyperbola. That means the area under the curve would be same. T into Q at any point of a rectangular hyperbola will give you the same result. And similarly, we have got relatively elastic demand, where demand is greater than 1, however less than infinity. So demand lies between 1 to infinity is relatively elastic. And when the elasticity of demand lies between 0 to 1, we call it relatively inelastic. So whatever product we are dealing with, we can compute the price elasticity using the data, and we know whether our product is generally these perfectly elastic and perfectly inelastic are extreme cases, but we will certainly know whether it is relatively elastic, relatively inelastic or unitarily elastic. So knowing this has got certain revenue implications which you will learn in market structure later. So now coming to the income elasticity, similarly I'm talking about the interpretation. The way we computed percentage change in quantity demanded to percentage change in price as price elasticity. Here we will be computing percentage change in quantity demanded as a result of percentage change in income, which will give us income elasticity. Now look at the interpretation here. The interpretation changes drastically. If the income elasticity or percentage change in quantity demanded divided by percentage change in income is greater than 1, the commodity is called as a luxury commodity. That means 1% change in income results in more than a percentage change in quantity demanded. This can happen in the case of luxury goods. But when the income elasticity is varying between 1 to 0, then the commodity is a necessity commodity. Though due to an 1% increase in income leads to 0.5 or 0.7% increase in the consumption. That means income increase has positive relationship with the consumption of the commodity. However, the magnitude is less than 1. That means, or even the price falls. For example, price of salt is falling by 20%. We may not increase the consumption by 20%. We may slightly increase, but we cannot increase by 20%. So necessities are goods where income elasticities are generally between 0 to 1. Similarly, in the case of inferior goods or even given goods, the income elasticity has to be less than 0. Now, coming to the cross price elasticity, this is percentage change in quantity demanded as a result of percentage change in price of other goods. Quantity demanded of X, and in earlier cases, in the price elasticity, it is own price change. But in the case of cross elasticity, we are looking at or we are interested in the price change of some other goods. For example, we are estimating the cross price elasticity of tea because of change in price of coffee. So here, two goods could either be substitutes or complements. So if we find the cross price elasticity to be positive, now in the case of income, we are looking the one as the benchmark. In the case of cross price elasticity, the sign condition matters. If the sign is positive, then we will conclude that the two goods are substitutes. That means sign is positive means if there is a fall in price, the quantity demanded is also falling. If there is an increase in price, the quantity demanded is also increasing. So that means in the case of a tea, if there is an increase in the price of tea, the quantity demand for coffee will increase. So the relationship is positive here. Cross price elasticity is positive. Therefore, they are substitute goods. In the case of complementary goods like pen and paper or car and petrol, we can expect a negative cross price elasticity. That means if the car price is falling, then the demand for petrol may also increase. So the relationship here is negative. Yeah. Now, how to measure this elasticity? We have different methods. One is an arc method of measuring this elasticity. Another is a point method. Arc method basically estimates elasticity at a over a range. So arc elasticity measures elasticity at midpoint of an arc. Arc means a part of a curve. Okay. So from the demand curve, suppose price is changing from P1 to P2. So P1 to P2, if it is not very small or infinitely small, then we will arrive at a range from point Q1 to Q2. The two points, the average or the midpoint, we are measuring. At the midpoint, we are measuring the arc elasticity of demand. So arc elasticity can be considered as the point elasticity at the midpoint of the line joining the two points. Yes, sir. So if you look at this arc methods, what is happening? The formula that is given is for arc elasticity computation. That is from suppose price falls from P1 to P2. Quantity demanded is increasing from Q1 to Q2. What is happening here? The change in quantity is nothing but Q2 minus Q1. That will give us the change in quantity or delta Q divided by the average change. Average change is obtained here by Q1 plus Q2 divided by 2. Similarly, the change in price is P2 minus P1, and which is divided by the average change in price P2 plus P1 by 2. So 2 cancels out, and by cross multiplications, we are getting Q2 minus Q1 by Q1 plus Q2 into P2 minus P1 by P1 plus P2. That is what is the formula for our arc elasticity of demand. So if you know the two points, it is possible for us to arrive at the arc elasticity. Similarly, point elasticity is the elasticity computed at a specific point. For example, at price P1 and Q1, we have a point in the demand curve. Suppose we would like to compute the price elasticity at the point where price is P1 and quantity is Q1. Let's tell that point as A. At that point, we can compute the price elasticity as delta Q1 by delta P1 into P1 by Q1, that is at price P1. That will give us the price elasticity. Here we are not talking about a range. We are computing the price elasticity at the point P1 itself. Similarly, we can compute the price elasticity of the combination P2, Q2. That would be delta Q2 by delta P2 into P2 by Q2. So at P2, we can obtain the price elasticity of demand. Yeah. So now we shall come to the demand forecasting, which is there in your unit 3. Demand forecasting is nothing but predicting future demand of a product or service on the basis of past events or prevailing trends in the present. So this is essential for our production planning, our inventory management, and for our assessing the future capacity or requirement. So this is what is basically the purpose of our demand forecasting. However, while forecasting demand, we need to look at the criteria that will lead us to a good demand forecasting. That requires our accuracy and the durability. The demand forecasting, if it is accurate, it is very difficult to obtain or forecast the demand very accurately, because there are a lot of complications. We are dealing with the economy, we are dealing with uncertainty, and predicting and accurately the future demand is very difficult. But it is told that even if you are able to predict the demand up to 70-80% accuracy level, you have done a marvelous job as a manager. Because if you are not able to forecast, or you are not able to forecast demand, and you produce very, very less than what is demanded, or you overproduce, it would be a huge loss to the company. So accuracy has to be, you have to use sophisticated techniques, tools, and then ensure that the accuracy is there. So the closer you are to the actual, you would be, it would be better for the better interest of the company. Again, if you estimate, you should, the estimate takes a lot of time and energy. Therefore, to a certain degree, it should be durable. It should not be such that your prediction is valid for only 2 days, 3 days, and then next day it again changes. So it should be to some extent durable for over a period of time. Then only it makes a lot of sense. Yeah. Now, level of demand forecasting. The demand can be forecasted at macro level, or at the industrial level, or even at micro or the farm level. So the all the three level, it is possible to forecast the demand. So coming to the, these are the three basic level, and the techniques that we are using are there. There are certain subjective methods of demand forecasting, and there are certain statistical methods of demand forecasting. Let's come to the subjective methods of demand forecasting. The subjective methods of demand forecasting are basically the survey techniques or complete enumeration method. It is just like a population. Population means you are surveying the entire set of consumers. And the other technique is the sample survey. But complete enumeration method is difficult. You cannot do it unless and until you have sufficient time, sufficient money at your hand, and then it is time consuming and resource consuming as well. So many people adopt this survey or sample survey. They choose a sample of population and then do the survey. Then expert opinion methods, views of specialist can be taken, and they are, because they are tracking the market, they are expert in that fields. You can engage them, discuss with them to know about the future expected demand. Then the market experiments, third category. Yeah. So we can have two different types. One is a group discussion methods in the expert opinion methods, under expert opinion capacity. Group discussion is where the conclusion is derived. This group is formed out of expert again. Expert in the, those who understand the market of a particular product. So conclusion is derived at through brainstorming sessions or by structured discussions. So 3-4 experts put together, they will give their opinion and they do their brainstorming and then arrive at a conclusion. Yes, there is likely that the demand may fall or demand may go up with to certain percentage. So this is a group discussion technique. Similarly, Dolphy technique is there. Here, experts' opinions are obtained without any face-to-face interactions. So you ask the experts at the first stage and then take their opinion without any face-to-face interaction between them. Then these experts are given a summary of the opinion of other experts to review their previous replies. So once 10-20 experts, they are giving their opinion, you circulate what other experts are telling to the rest of the, to each of them. So whatever one expert is telling should be circulated to rest of the experts. Now these people will go through what others are telling, their peer groups are telling, and then they are given a chance to correct their opinion. And based on the revised opinion, they will again conclude and they will change their reply. They are given a chance to change their reply. Now the group eventually converts towards a correct answer because they take into account other expert opinions and then form their own opinion again. This is the Dolphy technique, basically. Yeah. Then market experiment, test marketing, and controlled experiments. What is test marketing? In the case of test marketing, basically in the next page, it is there that a test area is selected, which is representative of the market where the new product is to be launched. So in the test marketing, we have to identify a representative set of consumer and a market for it. And by introducing a new product in the test market, the consumer response is studied, how they're reacting towards the new product. Then the actual consumer behavior is used for forecasting, and then the product is launched according at other places too. So this is about the test marketing. Then similarly, controlled experiments is there. In the case of controlled experiments, the selected representative consumer of a product and the target markets. We are selecting a representative consumers of a product and the target market. Once the selection is done carefully, they are then asked to visit a shopping store which is pre-arranged. How it is to be arranged? The various brands of the products are available. And in that shopping store, their preferences are recorded. What is that they are preferring over, why they are preferring one particular product or brand over something else, some other brand. These informations are recorded. Once that is recorded, after that, they are provided the advertising or promotional materials about different brands, and they make them aware about other product. So this, what is that, advertisement or promotion also is done there, and a certain amount of money is also given to them to exercise their production choice. So based on that, the data is generated and is used to understand the purchase behavior, and subsequently this is simulated for demand forecasting. So this is what is controlled experiment method. Now we can come to the statistical methods of demand forecasting. Here, different techniques like regression analysis is there. Under regression analysis, we have time series method. That is, this method generally implies an assumption of a continuation of past trends in future. So we are basically previous slicer. Here, basically, we are talking about the time series, means we are using the past data, demand and price data in past to predict the future demand. So in this case, we have this, suppose the data is not smooth, there are certain time series techniques like moving average method, smoothing of the data, that techniques are used to smooth the data and then forecast is done. Now, under regression analysis, we have linear regression, we have nonlinear regression, we have simultaneous equation model, we have time series regression model, we have panel data model. Panel data is something where we have got different space cross section data and different location. Now, all these models, time series data also is there and cross section data. For example, suppose a farm is present in 30-40 different countries. Now, it is not enough for him to predict the demand for a particular location. For example, the overall demand is not enough, it is essential for the farm to estimate the demand in each of the country so that he can arrange or make the supply available when the quantities are demanded. So we can use this time series, this panel data regression technique, which is largely used in the industry to ensure that or to estimate that how much demand is there in UK, how much demand is there in India, how much demand is there in Italy, how much demand is there in Australia or any other country. So apart from estimating the overall demand, location wise demand needs to be estimated. For example, the same technique can be used to judge the demand across different states in India. So these are the techniques like regression techniques where the quantity demand is a dependent variable and other variables like your income, price of related goods, price of substitute goods or complement goods, that is related goods, the weather, the credit availability, all these factors. Now here I would like to tell that if there is a change in price, it always leads to movement along the demand curve. But if there is a change in any other factor, for example, a change in income will not lead to movement along the demand curve. A change in income will always lead to shift in the demand curve, or change in price of related goods, change in any other factor other than price would lead to shift in the demand curve. So demand curve will shift and we will arrive at altogether new demand curve as a result of change in any other factor other than demand. So we are looking at, we should understand our dependent and independent variable. What is more relevant, we should take into the model, the more relevant variable, and then run the regression to obtain result. There are a lot of statistical packages like R, you have SPSS, even Excel will be useful. We can use these softwares and then do the regression to conclude or to forecast the demand. Yeah. Now, another statistical method is barometric techniques. What is this barometric techniques or lead or lag methods? The behavior of another variable or its lag is used to forecast the co-movement if the co-movement is established. That means it is possible for us, suppose there are two goods, the disposable income is increasing, in future the luxury goods demand may increase. So if you see the disposable income is increasing in a good percentage, you can foresee that later on the demand for luxury goods may increase because people are having more money in their hand. So it is giving us a clue that the growth in disposable income is giving us a clue regarding future increasing demand of the luxury goods. And if we can establish a relationship, if there is 1% or 5% change in disposable income, how much the luxury goods demand is increasing, then it would be useful for us. For that, we have to design an appropriate model. Similarly, industrial consumption. So, of electricity. So, for example, now we are talking about the industrial consumption of electricity. Means at present, suppose I am not sure what is happening because of this COVID-19, what is happening to the industrial production? Has it really gone down? Is it constant or it is likely to increase? So I would look at one data that will give me the clue. This is a barometer. Like barometer, it will indicate me what is the industrial consumption of electricity. If the industrial consumption of electricity has not fallen drastically, that means production is on. Am I right? So that may give a clue that yes, industrial production is not like has not gone down because of certain things. But if the industrial consumption of electricity has fallen drastically, means industry is closed down and they are not producing at all. That will give me an hint that industrial production is falling. Similarly, input prices. For example, the input price today has fallen, or producer price index, or increased. If the input price is increasing, that means the cost of the production is increasing, and that may result in a future increase in the price of the product. So this input price change will give me the indication that in future the demand, the product prices are going to increase those products for which these inputs are being used. So we use the producer price index to forecast as a barometer to see what is happening to the consumer price index in a later date. So lag variable is a time lag. So what is happening to input price today will happen to the consumer price tomorrow. What is happening to electric consumption today would happen to industrial production tomorrow. What is happening with disposable income today? Today is a lag variable. Tomorrow or after a few months, that would be reflected in the demand for luxury goods. So this is basically the barometric technique or lead or lag methods that we use to forecast the demand. So here we basically discussed what is the role of a manager, managerial economics, and then what is the role of a manager. Then we also discussed about the demand, the elasticity of demand, how they can be interpreted, like your price elasticity of demand and the income elasticity of demand, then the cross price elasticity of demand, and how we can infer managerial information or decision, or how it can be used for managerial decision making. Then we have learned various forecasting technique, the basic of it, because there is no in your SLM, there is nothing much on the mathematics part of it. Yeah. With this, I would like to thank, and then over to Sunita and Ansuman sir. Any question?
So the presentation session is over. Now learners can ask their queries. So sir can clarify. If any query, then learners can ask. Dear learners, if from your side, if any doubt or any query, then please ask. I think first of all, I would like to say thanks to our resource person, Sir Dr. Asis sir, because and here I think sir very very beautifully discussed and explained all topics relating to managerial economics. As he said that first of all, he started from introductory part of managerial economics, that what is managerial economics, and it is basically the combination of economic theory and decision science, which is needed to solve out the managerial decision problems. And then he switch over to the demand concept or demand analysis, and he very beautifully explained all the topics or all the concepts relating to demand analysis, such as concept of demand, law of demand, and what are the exceptions to the law of demand, then how the individual demand schedule will derive, what how demand function is written, and what are the determinants of demand, and what are the concept of elasticity and different types of elasticity. Every point he clearly explained and very beautifully explained. So I think there is no doubt on the side of our learners. So once again, for such a wonderful presentation, I would like to thank our sir. Thank you, sir.
When will be the second class for next law? Somebody knows that. So I think it is next week. It will be scheduled and then communicated to you.
Thank you, sir, for this class.
Thank you. So, Ansuman sir, anything else? Shall we?
So, Kanishka, I have one request to you. Kindly use the Google Drive link, Google Forms link that was already circulated in the comment section. Please click on it and give your feedback about the particular session. I take this opportunity to thank you and the previous participants, those who have joined us. I thank Ashish sir, Sunita ma'am for their involvement and initiative. I also thank Srimay sir for joining us. So now, if we don't have any other questions or any, if you have anything to say, please go ahead, or we will officially close this session. So do you have anything to say, Ashish sir?
I can summarize, and if it is required or if it is clear, no need.
Yes, sir, we can.
I'm taking some question, but I see only one student here, probably.
Yes.
Not many have joined.
So we can
Kanishka, if you have any questions, please feel free.
No, sir, it was very clear. So no question is there. Thank you, sir, for explaining in such a nice way.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So may I please request each and every one of us connected at present in this session to kindly disengage from the platform. So please log out. The session ends here. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Bye, sir.